Tonight's broadcast is made possible with the support of these underwriters.
Half of the Mid-Eastern Conference schedule gets underway this week, and all four of the New Hanover County girls basketball teams are eyeing top spot in the division coming off results from Friday night. Good evening, everyone. I'm Joe Katz from PortCityDaily.com. Welcome to another edition of Sports Roundtable, our weekly look at high school basketball across New Hanover County. Remember to log on to PortCityDaily.com for the latest scores, stats, and highlights across the Wilmington area for free online at PortCityDaily.com. Tonight, we'll catch up with the four girls basketball coaches inside the county. But before we get to our first guest, a quick recap to date as we head through the final month or so of the regular season. The Hoggard girls basketball team suffered their first loss in conference play back on Friday night, a 42-36 setback to Laney. Jada Malone had a game high 15 points, scoring 10 of those 15 points in the third quarter for the Bucks. Lexi Melville added 12. Bailey Edwards had 10 to put three players in double figures for Laney. The Vikings saw their seven-game winning streak come to a close. Ashley took the ride down to Shallotte this past Friday and picked up a win to keep pace in the division following a 44-29 victory over West Brunswick. Carly Barron had 10 points in the win. So as we stand right now, the conference is up for grabs when talking about the four A schools in the split Mid-Eastern Conference. Hoggard and New Hanover are both 5-1. Ashley and Laney at 4-2. And each of these teams will play each other one more time during the regular season. That will bring us to our first guest tonight. And he's the head coach of the Hoggard Vikings, Boubacar Awe. And coach, tough loss on Friday night. Obviously, your first setback in conference, dealing with some injuries right now, some mid-season woes, I guess, coming off a day off of school, getting into action on Friday. You shot about 19% from the floor on Friday night. But with that said, maybe the loss came at a good time for the Vikings as you've cruised through conference until, you know, this past Friday night.
Well, absolutely. I felt like we weren't playing our best basketball game since you mentioned it. I mean, we won seven straight games. And, you know, when you're dealing with young people, they get careless and they start thinking they are too good. But, you know, it's not all negative. I think loss came at a really good time, you know, and now maybe we can help us get focused again. But that was a very weird game, but you got to give a lot of credit to Laney. I mean, Coach Tynes had the girls prepared to play. I mean, you know, and they play a really good basketball game. They, you know, they had three girls in double figured. I mean, Jada really had a really good game. But you know, they played well. I mean, you know, and we didn't. And that's what it comes down to.
Well, I kind of said it before the game and when I talked to you at practice last week, was the fact that anytime you get these four in-county schools together, you could throw the record, the standings, out of the picture for at least that night. And that was the case on Friday, obviously not putting in your best effort. You do have some injuries. But with that said, I knew going into that game that you were kind of worried with the fact that, you know, maybe your players were feeling a little bit too overconfident maybe in how they've run through the schedule and a good rude awakening for them heading through this week, a busy week for you.
Well, absolutely. This game is so mental, man. You can never go into game thinking that. I remind them all the time, you play the game because it's decided on the court, not on papers. I don't care who you are. And especially when you're talking about a rivalry game, you got to show up and play. You know, like you said, we do this with some injury, but that's no excuse. You know, we just didn't play good basketball. I mean, defensively, probably the worst defensive game we probably played, you know, the whole year. You know, but you also, you got to give a lot of credit to Laney because they, you know, they executed a perfect game plan. And, And they won the game. They deserved it.
Yeah, they ended up shooting something like 70% from the floor in that game compared to 19% for you. So, you know, shooting woes. You know, you struggle to shoot the ball and get the ball on the bottom of the net throughout the court at portions this season. Mm-hmm. With that said, some of those injuries, Alani Fisher, a key contributor this year, transfer from Charlotte. Caitlin Brannon, another player that has, you know, put forth a good effort for you, especially on the defensive end of the floor. They were injured last week. We expect them to be back in the lineup this week.
Absolutely. I mean, throughout the year, we haven't really shot the ball like the way I think we are capable of shooting it, especially at practice. I mean, you talk about some good shooters. I've seen some good shooters, but, you know, it only matters in games, though. But I think the thing I was disappointed the most with our defensive effort, you know, we didn't even intend to play defense on anybody. We basically, the assignment completely missed assignment and stuff like that. And you cannot do that against a good team like Laney, well-coached team. And but, you know, we were dealing with injury. You got Caitlin, which is probably one of my best defensive player. I mean, tough, hard-nosed player and good defensive player as well. Not, you know, dealing with some issues right now. So we got to give those time to rest. We also have Alani, which is probably my best shooter, and she wasn't able to play. But, you know, that's what it takes.
Yeah, that happens throughout the course of a season. You need some players to step up to fill in those roles. We talked last week during practice, as I stopped by, about your two senior leaders and your team captains, and Aaliyah Thompson and Emma Haywood, and what they've been through for the last 4 years. They're your first class of freshmen now to be seniors, to have gone through your program for 4 years. And we talked about, you know, what they've learned from you, what you've learned from them over the course of these 3 years. And I think one of the things that stuck with me the most was the fact that they, despite playing other sports and focusing on those other sports, that they thought that the, you know, the instinct and the effort to push them forward harder mentally was instilled through your efforts as a basketball coach. And I thought I took that, you know, with me the most, was that they, you know, they're pushed by you and they want to improve themselves more now because of the things that you've instilled over the last couple of years.
Well, absolutely. I mean, what are two special girls. I mean, Emma and Ali, you know, I don't even like to talk about them a whole lot because I start tearing up because those girls, you know, they meant so much to me. I mean, if I'm here right now and we talk about Haga girls basketball, if those two, because, you know, I know the change will come with those two if they buy into it, and I, you know, and they understood that. It wasn't all smooth, but, you know, it's been rough. But, man, those are two special girls. I mean, they are even better human beings off the court. I mean, and that's what, you know, it's not always about wins or losses, man, but sometimes you come across girls like that, you're like, wow, what a two special girl. And I'm proud of those girls as I've ever been with any other players, man. Probably, I mean, arguably, somebody would have, probably to me, some of the, you know, two best players that I've ever played at Hoggett, you know, in my book, you know, I'll never forget those two girls, because I mean, that's how much I love them. They mean a lot to me.
Team captains Aaliyah Thompson and Emma Haywood. Haywood, the leading scorer for the Vikings this year. Thompson has taken over as a presence inside the paint. He's Coach Boubacar Awe. The Vikings are 5-1 in conference right now, so you do have more wins than losses, even though you don't always look at wins and losses when it matters. But 5-1 in the conference and looking to stay atop the division. Coach, good luck this week. I know it's a busy one for you, and get back in the win column come Wednesday and Friday.
Thank you, Joe. I appreciate it.
Hoggard girls basketball coach Boubacar Awe here on Sports Roundtable. We'll catch up with the three other coaches from across New Hanover County right after this quick break. High school basketball fans, welcome back to Sports Roundtable, our weekly look at high school hoops across New Hanover County. Thanks again to Coach Boubacar Awe of the Hoggard Vikings for stopping by as we catch up with the four girls basketball coaches at the varsity level from across the county this week. As I mentioned at the top, we have a jambalaya of four teams across the division right now, all within one game of each other. Hoggard, New Hanover at 5-1. Ashley and now Laney at 4-2, coming off big victories on Friday night. And that will bring us to the Laney girls basketball coach, Sherry Tynes, here on stage with us this evening. And Coach Tynes, you know, at the game Friday night, as we kind of talked just before, wasn't the prettiest basketball game, but at the end of the day, you shot the lights out, probably your best shooting effort of the season, without a doubt your best shooting effort of the season. And, you know, you go up against the Dragon and the top team in Hoggard, and you slayed them on Friday. So at the end of the day, you're right back in the mix, one game out of the division. You're going to play your three cross-county rivals again this year. So as you kind of scripted it at the beginning of the season, obviously with some injuries there to Jensen Edwards. Right now, you couldn't ask to be in a better place at 4-2 and one game out from first place.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Friday's game was a great boost for the girls. You know, and a lot of things came together for us on Friday night. And, you know, our biggest hope now is that will carry over into this week and next week. And, you know, we can kind of get on a roll here. But, yeah, I mean, we shot unbelievable. I mean, 67%, you know, we'll take that any night.
Right.
But, yeah, you know, and we've been thinking it all year long. You know, we're getting the looks, we're getting the open shots. It's just a matter of the kids having the confidence to knock those shots down. And, you know, it all came together for us on Friday. As well as I thought defensively, I thought probably one of our better games that we've had all year long. So, you know, when you get those two things going, then you're in good shape. You know, struggled a little bit with their press, but, you know, found a way somehow to manage right. that, but certainly something we need to get better at.
One thing that I noticed, I think offensively too, you talk about confidence, you know, have struggled shooting the ball throughout the course of this year. Obviously, you know, no thing about it right there. But with that said, you get some baskets to go in against a good Hogger team. You get your scores kind of feeling, you know, confident that they can mm-hmm. make those shots when they get them. I mean, that's something that can, you know, you can take from and build off of going through this next week at least.
Oh, absolutely. And just the confidence factor, you know, it doesn't matter how much we believe in our kids. You know, if they don't believe in themselves, then it doesn't matter. But, you know, it was just a great team effort. You know, we had a great week of preparation. Just back to basics with basketball, not necessarily Hogger, but just got back to some basics and, you know, made a few adjustments to try to prepare for Hogger. And again, like I said, it just, you know, it came together. The kids were all tuned in on the same page. And, you know, credit to all the kids because it took the preparation to get us to that point, whether or not the kids played or not in that particular game. Without them, we would have not been prepared for that game. So again, we're just hoping to keep up that same routine and maybe surprise a few more people.
And that's one of the things I think that is often overlooked, especially when you're a player and you don't get a lot of minutes out there, but you're still practicing all the time, is the fact that it does take an entire roster up and down from your number one player to your number 11 or 12 player, because those are the people you're practicing against. Those are the scout defenses, scout offenses, yep. the people that are going to push those starting players to make that better effort. So absolutely, I agree with you 100% that it takes an entire team and roster to win a game and win a championship. With that said, Lexi Melville, someone that started off well for you in that game against Hogger. She scored 7 of 9 points in that first quarter. Jada Malone picked up with 10 of the 15 points scored in the third quarter. And then you had Bailey Edwards that kind of hangs around, scores her 10 to 15 points per game. That's the kind of recipe on the offensive end that you're going to need to continue in order to be successful.
We are. And you know, you got to have that. You know, we're not going to score a lot of points, but, you know, we got to take advantage of our opportunities. And, you know, we got to continue to play defense, I think, to give ourselves a chance to compete, to have that opportunity down the stretch to win the ball games. And, you know, just continue to get better on our ball handling and working against pressure defense and half-court presses and stuff. But, you know, we're a little bit undersized, so sometimes I think that gives us it makes it harder for us right. to, you know, we know what we need to do, but it's really tough when the kids you're playing are, you know, 1-2 feet taller than you are. It makes it really tough, but, you know, you can't quit. You just got to keep fighting, and it might not be pretty, but you got to get that ball across half court and you know, get the job done. So that's what we're going to keep doing.
Well, you can't teach heart no matter what the size
that's
is.
Right.
And on Friday
that's
night,
right.
you had a lot of heart in that ball game to pull out the win. Two other things I thought I noticed, or at least one other thing, you know, Lexi goes down in some foul trouble early in the ball game, so you had to go into that bench and, you know, and some, you know, players put in some big minutes for you, and that was a key, especially in that second quarter, I think.
Yeah,
that
they
kept
did.
Pace with you.
Yeah, because, you know, I think we had to sit Bailey out as well eventually in that second quarter. She picked up her second foul, but, you know, we kind of limped to the halftime. We didn't score many points after those guys went out, but we didn't give up any points. Right. So, again, defensively, you know, kept us in the game and kept it close and kept it to where it was doable for us coming into the second half. So just, you know, very pleased with the effort there of all the kids. Like I said before, you know, where they played a minute or 20 minutes, it took all of them on that particular night to get that win.
Lastly, a couple of games obviously coming up this week, big games. Now every game's a big game as we head through the stretch run of the conference schedule. You come up with a game on Wednesday, and then you go to New Hanover on Friday, mm-hmm. And not overlooking Wednesday's game, but looking into Friday against the Wildcats, you know, a team obviously you're very familiar with and what they can do and the challenges Brogdon Hall brings to some players oftentimes on the shooting side, not mm-hmm. used to, you know, just the scenery around the mm-hmm. arena. So maybe some things that you can take with you going into Friday that you know, you want to let the listeners know?
Yeah, just confidence. You know, it's the basket's the same height. You know, it's you know, you don't have to shoot any differently. You know, you got to get back in transition defense on those guys because they like to score a lot of points, you know, in transition. And, you know, I thought we competed and played fairly well when they came to our place. I think, you know, we just couldn't hang on and finish. But certainly a lot came from that game for us, and we're certainly going to work on that between now and Friday. And again, it's just confidence is the biggest thing, you know, confidence that you're as good as the next guy, and you know, take that into the game and see a few shots go in, anything can happen. So, but you know, a big game at Brogdon Hall, a tough place to play, but again, it's, you know, the basket's the same height, the free throw line's the same distance away, so you know, hopefully that won't be a factor for us. But definitely got to get through West on Wednesday night. You know, they're a much improved team. They try to do lots of different stuff defensively, so if your kids aren't focused and in the moment, then it can cause some problems for you. So
the Lady Bucks are 4-2 in the conference, hanging in one game back from top spot in the division. Coach Sherry Tynes here on Sports Roundtable. Coach, always a pleasure.
Thanks.
We'll catch up with her in a couple of weeks as we continue our conversation this evening here on Sports Roundtable. Up next, the head coaches from Ashley High School and New Hanover coming up after this quick break. We're talking high school basketball here on Sports Roundtable tonight. I'm Joe Katz from PortCityDaily.com. Don't forget, latest score stats and highlights online for free at PortCityDaily.com across the Wilmington area as we continue our conversation this evening with the four high school girls basketball coaches from across New Hanover County. Up next, the head coach of the New Hanover Wildcats, Bertha Dixon Wright. And coach, you know, 10-day hiatus since your last time out. You did pick up a win, I guess, many moons ago against Ashley. But with that said, due to some other things going on in the conference right now, you're tied atop the division at 5-1. Ashley and Laney are at 4-2. So it's anybody's conference right now as we head through the second portion of the schedule. And we get that underway this week.
That's right.
Some big games coming up for you, Coach. But yes. With the 10-day break, what have you been working on? What do you expect from your players come the next game, next time you hit the floor?
Yeah, well, the 10-day break is scary. You know, there's a lot of teams that might say we need to take some time off, and I think all teams do, but when you talk 10 days, that's a long time not to play. So it's going to be a little scary. Each day we try to work on free throw shooting. We try to work on passing the ball, bounce passing, aggressive defense, boxing out. I mean, we had our little skills for each day. And then we didn't practice Friday because of the weather, but Saturday we tried to tie it all back in together. But it's been a long time since we've been on the court, so it's going to be interesting tonight.
So kind of going back to basics, fundamentals,
yes,
during that week off of practice.
Yes.
Now you get back on the floor, you know, 5-1 in the division. You get a West Brunswick team, and then you get Laney later on this week.
That's
two teams you've obviously played before and handled pretty easily during those games. Obviously, you picked up, you know, wins that were more than double-digit victories, at least against West Brunswick. Mm-hmm. So how do you keep them motivated at this point? They know that what they did the first time around, not as easy the second time around.
Right, and that's what we try to preach to them for these last few days. It's not going to be as easy. You know, we saw a bunch of our kids were actually at the Laney Hargett game, so they see what can happen. It's just not show up and play. It can't be that way. West Brunswick may not be as easy tonight unless we do the simple things right. And then we go to Topsail on Wednesday. It's a three-game week, so it's that's tough. But here it is, almost the end of the season, so you have to be ready. You have to be ready to step out there. And you have to accept the challenge. There's no excuses. You know, we've seen each other. They've seen us.
Right.
You just gotta run your sets. You know, they gotta stop us.
So you don't play in 10 days, and then you play three games in the course of 5 days. So hopefully, at least after the beginning of this week, your players will be conditioned and game ready for obviously some big games against Topsail, a much improved team, and then Laney at the end of this week. Going back to your last win over Ashley, wasn't the prettiest ball game. I think there were 60 combined turnovers. With that said, forced 40 turnovers in that game. And talking with you after the game a little bit, was that you were really just focusing on the defensive effort and trying to get better on defensively and picking up that intensity and obviously working on that this week.
Right, yeah. We realize we have a couple of kids who can score. If we give them the basket, give them the ball here, go to the basket, they can get that done. But I'm worried about us stopping other people. We can't step on the floor tonight and let a kid from West Brunswick score 10-plus points. That's our goal. No one scores double figures. Same thing when we step on the court Wednesday and Friday. No more double digits, you know. And so we've been working on hands off, bars off, moving our feet, communicating, helping your teammates out. So it's going to be interesting to see if we can put it all together in these three games in these 5 days. So
5-1 in the conference. Other teams are 4-2. You've got four four of the Wilmington schools that are all jumbled up there within one game in the division. At the end of the day, you look at your roster and you have basically no upperclassmen, one or two juniors and, you know, mostly sophomores. So while the future ahead looks pretty bright for the New Hanover basketball team, now is the time that these sophomores need to grow up and become juniors and seniors on the play. They have the experience, and now we go to the second portion of the conference.
That's right.
Now you expect them to, you know, play like upperclassmen rather than some of those rookie mistakes.
Right. And you know, you say that, but I've been expecting it ever since after the Christmas tournament. You know, but you're right. You're not a freshman anymore. You're not a sophomore anymore. You may be grade-wise, but you're not as far as this athletics is concerned. It's time for you to step and play. They know what we expect. Me, my coaching staff, they know what they have to do in order to be successful. They know that. In order to get the playing time, this is what you have to do. If you look at our roster, most of the time we've got four sophomores and one junior on the floor. Right. And, you know, that's the way we play. That's the way we have to play. And there's no excuses. You can't come to me and say, she did this, she pushed this. No excuses. Play basketball.
Well, one of those sophomores, Azaria Fields, has you know, run the point guard position for you, you know, pretty well this season for the most part. She's, you know, has tons of varsity experience before getting to New Hanover, obviously playing on the varsity team for Cape Fear Academy. But with that said, it seems like she can go hot and cold when she's shooting the ball. And when she gets hot, it's like there's no one's going to stop her, and the ball just seems to go in the bottom of the net no matter where she can shoot it from.
That's true. The Azara's biggest problem is she wants everybody else to score. And so when she realized, hey, I might be open, sometimes she's just not mentally ready to take that shot. So we've been working on that too. I need you to try to score. And then if somebody stops you, then it's time to dish the ball. So we want her to be a little unselfish. And she's been doing a great job of running the point for us. And we, like I said, look for her to do a little more.
Not too bad when you're talking about a point guard who likes to play selfless basketball. So that's one
that's
of the good
rare.
Traits of having a good point guard who can also score at times as well.
Yeah, that's rare. Yeah.
A couple of other players on the roster as we head down the final minute of our talk tonight. Imani Muhammad, a player that, you know, arguably could be potentially a Mid-Eastern Conference Player of the Year she comes into her own junior and senior year.
Yes.
She could shoot the ball from the outside. Side, and I think she brings a lot of positives to your basketball
team. Yes, aggression on defense, which is a plus. We had some problems at the beginning of the season with her being in foul trouble. We've kind of cut that back a little bit. We've been playing her some on the wing, playing her some inside, and she has that ability to do both. And like I said, we're still asking for her to do more.
New Hanover Wildcats are 5-1 in the division, currently tied with Hoggard for first place in the conference, looking to keep pace in the division with three more games coming up this week. Coach Bertha Dixon Wright, always a pleasure.
Thank you.
We'll see you later on.
Thank you, Joe.
All right, we'll take our final break here on Sports Roundtable. Ashley Coach Adrian Gale on deck coming up next. High school basketball fans, welcome back to Sports Roundtable. Wrapping up our discussion this evening with the four high school basketball coaches from New Hanover County. I'm Joe Katz from PortCityDaily.com. We've documented it plenty here in this half hour of the show this week that the Mid-Eastern Conference standings are a jumble atop the division right now with the four Wilmington schools all within one game of each other heading through the second half of the conference schedule, which gets underway this week. Our final guest this evening, the head coach of the Ashley Screaming Eagles, Adrian Gale. And coach, 4-2 in the conference, coming off a win last week over West Brunswick on the road, in position right now, one game back from top spot in the division, right where you want to be heading through this second part of the schedule.
Yeah, I mean, it was a huge upset on Friday night when we heard, and you know, it kind of has to give you a little bit of confidence knowing that the team we beat in overtime just beat, you know, the team that beat us pretty bad. So, you know, it gives you a little spark, a little extra fire during practices to get ready for the next opponent.
You know, you've been coaching teams that have played in the Mid-Eastern Conference and the Wilmington schools for a long time. We kind of talked about it earlier with the other guests, the other coaches, that, you know, when you get into these cross-county rivalry games, anything could happen on any given day. And we saw that Friday with Hoggard getting knocked off by Laney. And that's, again, got to give your team some confidence right now that, you know, what's happened is in the past, and all we can do is control our future, and you're in a good spot to, you know, make a move here.
Yeah, and that's one focus that I told the girls, you know, just the other day, saying that, you know, with teams in the past, we might not have been the best team in the conference, but anytime you play an in-town rival, it goes up, you know, the level of energy, and it's a toss-up. That's why you play the game. And, you know, we can't look back. We can try to remember, you know, what happened and use that as a little bit more fuel for how we play the next time. But you know, usually when you get these teams together in town, you never know really what's going
to
happen.
Going to some of the highlights from Wednesday night's or Friday night's 44-29 win over West Brunswick. Carly Barron had 10 points in the victory for you, a player that has stepped up at least as of late to help fill in that scoring column with Lola Lovett still out with an injury. We'll get to her injury in a minute. But what did you see through this West Brunswick game that, you know, some positives that you're going to take with you through this week?
Some positives we saw defensively. We had a great first half. And then second half, we kind of slowed down a little bit, took the pedal off on the defense end, but you saw what we could do defensively, good on the ball pressure, et cetera. And then, like I said, Carly did a great job shooting that night. I forget what her percentage was, but as a team, I think we were 48%. Okay. So that was probably our best shooting night or scoring night percentage-wise all season, having 48%. So that helps when you knock down those baskets.
A couple of the players that have really stood out to me here the last couple of weeks as we, you know, get ready for this final push for you. Serenity Williams, your point guard, has you know, shown signs of you know, of being you know, what she can be, as what I've seen as a point guard, and really dictates the control of the game. And what are you doing to push her to be more consistent throughout the course of a four-quarter game?
Well, I think that's our focus on everybody, because it's like when she has a good game, no one else is really scoring that much. You know, the posts really aren't touching it that much. And we just want to try to get more consistent around the board. And once we do that, I think, you know, we'll be playing better basketball and be able to compete a little bit better. You know, with her, she has one speed. So, you know, we try to tell her that, you know, she you know, obviously we want to get up the court, but there's situations and times where we want to, you know, bring it back a little bit and run some time off the clock and set up some offensive sets.
So still fine tuning at the point guard position. You know, you have some bigs down low in the paint, Dana Craig being one of those, and then you add a couple of shooters around her. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the season, that I thought, you know, on paper, I know the games aren't played on paper, but on paper, you know, you're match up with anybody in the conference just as good as anybody else.
Yeah, I think at this point we just need to get some a little bit more confidence and understanding and using our strengths. And you know, we've been pounding it in our heads. Now they just have to go out and pound it on the court. So
the leading scorer, or one of your leading scorers going into this year, Lola Lovett, she's been out for much of the season with the injury to her leg or foot. And what I saw her moving around in the boot about 10 days ago. What's her status as we get ready for this?
Well, she's out of the boot, and she was released to practice this past week, and she's released to play in tonight's game, Monday night's game. So we'll see. We're going to probably ease her in, just being out those many days, right, and then just seeing what she can handle. And then hopefully by Friday's game, because we don't play Wednesday, that she'll be able to be a little bit, you know, closer to 100%.
Coming back in the lineup and be consistent for you as she's been throughout the course of her playing career over at Ashley. Lastly, I guess, when it's very easy to get up, you know, and pumped up for a crosstown rivalry game against a team that, you know, is just down the street from you. But the 3A schools here in the conference, they've struggled this year. But with that said, you still need to bring your best game on the floor anytime you play. And how important is that to make sure that the girls aren't overlooking some of these games that are coming up to make sure you stay relevant when you do go up against the Wilmington schools?
Well, I think we had some slips in the season, so you know, we understand that we're just going to take one day, one practice, one game at a time, and just look and try to get better each day. Right. So with that said, we're not going to underestimate anybody, because we've seen our highs and we've seen our lows. And when we're at our lows, you know, we can get beat by anybody. And when we're at our highs, we can play with anybody. So we just need, again, it's just about consistency and trying to, you know, keep our highs high and don't let our lows get so low as we continue throughout the season.
Ashley coach Adrian Gale here on Sports Roundtable. The Screaming Eagles are 4-2 right now, looking to improve their conference record as we get through the second part of our league schedule this week. Ashley, one game out from top spot in the conference, right where you want to be, coach.
Yep.
Looking Coach Adrian Gale, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll catch you up in a couple of weeks. That will do it for our latest edition of Sports Roundtable. Thanks again to all four of the varsity girls basketball coaches for stopping by tonight here on the show. Next week, it'll be the boys who are up to talk with the four coaches from across New Hanover County. For everyone here inside the New Hanover County Schools TV studio, I'm Joe Katz. We'll talk to you next week.